Greetings, friends and brethren. This is Dr. Bob Thiel, the Continuing Church of God. And what I'd like to do today are go through 10 restored truths that the late Herbert W. Armstrong said he restored to the Church of God that the Sardis era of the Church of God no longer had, at least not when he became part of them, at least not in his view. Now, the previous part of this sermon, I went through parts 1 through 8, or truths, if you will, 1 through 8. In his book, The Mystery of the Ages, the late Herbert Armstrong wrote that he believed that God used him to restore at least 18 truths to the Philadelphia portion of the Church of God, or Philadelphia era of the Church of God, that the Sardis era no longer had. Now, if you've got your Bibles, I want to go to the book of Revelation, Revelation chapter 3. And you see, starting in verse 1, it talks about the message of the angel of the church in Sardis. And the end of that verse, it says, I see your works. You've got a name that you're alive, but you're dead. Now, this is a church of God. Verse 2, be watchful and strengthen the things which remain for there that are ready to die, for I've not found your works perfect before God. Now, one of the things I want to comment here is that this particular church of God, there's still some of it left, has lost more and more truths, if you will, since Herbert W. Armstrong died, especially on the prophetic side. Notice verse 3, it says, remember therefore how you've received and heard, hold fast and repent. So they're told that, look, you should remember what you first got. You better repent because you're losing it. Anyway, Herbert Armstrong felt that they lost at least 18 things that he believed God used him to restore. In the previous portion of this, I listed the 18 truths. And today, I'd like to just, before I start in the last 10, read through the first eight of them that I went through last time. According to Herbert Armstrong, the ones that he restored were, number one, the true gospel; two, the purpose of God; three, God's plan for the holy days; four, proper hierarchical church government; five, who and what is God; six, what and why is man; seven, the spirit man; and eight, that Christians are first fruits of this age. Today, what I'd like to do during this sermon is cover the rest of the 18. So I'm going to start with the ninth item that he believed he restored to that particular church. Oh, by the way, I was reading from a booklet that we have called The Continuing History of the Church of God. And it has those 18 truths listed in there, but also has history of the true Christian church from the time it began in Acts chapter 2 through present. A lot of historical information, a lot of factual information, a lot of scriptures, if you want to find out who the true Christian church is, but also these 18 truths are listed in there. Well, getting to the truths, Herbert Armstrong gave a sermon on the 17th of December, 1983. It was called The Mission of the Philadelphia Church Era, and he talked about the message, and he started to list different truths. And the next one that he mentioned had to do with the millennium. So I'm going to read what he said. He said, the knowledge of the millennium and what it is. The Sardis people, again, this is people in the Church of God that he considered to be part of the Sardis era of the church. The Sardis people knew that Christ would rule 1,000 years. So he knew they knew something about the millennium. They knew it would be a millennium. They had no idea in the world about what would happen in a millennium. They had no idea what the purpose of the millennium was. Then Herbert Armstrong says, we, the Philadelphia era of the Church of God, we know when we assemble at the Feast of Tabernacles, that's what we're celebrating. And we know what's going to happen in the millennium, and that salvation will be open to all then that are still alive, but it's not open to all now. He says, no other church knows that. These are things that you, brethren, are privileged to know. You, God, has blessed with this knowledge and restored this knowledge to you. So where did he get the idea about the millennium? Well, let's go to the Bible in Revelation chapter 20. Starting in verse 4, I'm going to read from the New King James Version of the Bible, Revelation 20, starting in verse 4. And I saw thrones, and they sat on them, and judgment was committed to them. Then I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded for their witness to Jesus and for the word of God, who had not worshipped the beast or his image, and had not received his mark on their foreheads or on their hands. And they lived and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. verse 5 of Revelation 20. But the rest of the dead did not live again until the 1,000 years were finished. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy is he who is part in the first resurrection. Over such, the second death has no power. But they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years. So this is from the Bible. Now, one thing that I've tried to do in this two-part sermon that I have not seen done anywhere else, and perhaps I should reiterate something from the previous sermon, Herbert Armstrong said that these 18 truths that he restored were truths that were held by the original Christian church, the Ephesus church, the Ephesus era of the church. And while he made that claim, I had not seen him or anyone else go through each of the 18 truths and try to show from history that Herbert Armstrong was correct. Now, obviously, some people say, I only want to see the Bible. That's great. And I just quoted from the Bible this idea about the millennium. But Herbert Armstrong took it a step further when said that the Ephesus era of the Church of God believed these 18 truths. And how are you going to find that? Well, since the Bible doesn't tell us everything that the people in Ephesus believed during that time period, during the Ephesus era, we have to look at records of church history. One of the reasons I showed the booklet about church history. And I'd like to read something from a guy by the name of Papias. Now, he claimed to know the apostles, and in the early second century, here's what he taught. He says, there'll be a period of 1,000 years after the resurrection of the dead that the kingdom of Christ will be set up in material form on the earth. So that's something that Papias taught, and it was something about the millennium. So this idea was certainly taught during Ephesus era. And I'd like to read something from the fragments of Papias, because he talked about what it would be like during the millennium. It's the time of great abundance, which is what the Feast of Tabernacles pictures, by the way. One of the things it pictures. So here's something he taught. In like manner, he said a grain of wheat would produce 10,000 ears, and every ear would produce would have 10,000 grains, and every grain would yield 10 pounds of clear, pure, fine flour, and that apples and seeds and grass would produce in similar proportions, that all the animals feeding then only on the productions of the earth, they would become peaceable and harmonious and be in perfect subjection to man. That's what Papias said. And if you've been in the Church of God for any length of time, and you've attended the Feast of Tabernacles, this idea about having an abundance and the animals eating vegetables and being peaceable comes from the book of Isaiah, and those scriptures are typically taught by the Church of God during the Feast of Tabernacles. The other part of this, perhaps I should mention, is that there are other people now who professed Christ during this time, who are not in the Church of God, but they understood aspects of it. For example, they understood this idea, or they taught this idea that God had a 6,000-year plan, and the millennium was the last day, a 1,000-year day, in a stricter plan. For example, the so-called Epistle of Barnabas said, moreover, concerning the Sabbath, as it is written in the 10 words, the word 10 words means the 10 commandments, in which he spoke to Moses face to face on Mount Sinai. He says, you shall hallow the Sabbath of the Lord with pure hands and with a pure heart. Another place he says, if my sons observe the Sabbath, I will bestow mercy on them. Of the Sabbath he speaks at the beginning of the creation, and God made the works of his hand in 6 days and ended the seventh day and rested on it. And you can read about that in Genesis 2, but I'm reading from a second century writing here. God, to give heed, children, what this means. He ended in 6 days. He means this, that in 6,000 years the Lord will bring the end, all things to the end, for that day with him signifying 1,000 years. And he himself bore witness, saying, behold, the day of the Lord shall be as 1,000 years. Therefore, children, in 6 days, as is 6,000 years, everything shall come to an end. And he rests the seventh day, by which he means his son is going to come and abolish the time of the lawless one. Now, the lawless one, he was referring to the man of sin the Bible talked about. But also, during that 1,000 years, and I didn't read this, But in Revelation 20, verses 1 through 3, we find out that Satan is going to be bound for the 1,000 years during that time. At the end of the 2nd century, somebody who was also not in the Church of God wrote that there was a synchronism of times. And so it says from this, be required 6,000 years. And he did this saying that the world will stand only 6,000 years as it is. Then there was somebody who claimed to know Polycarp, a guy by the name of Irenaeus. Now he strayed from Church of God doctrine, but he said he was exposed to Polycarp, and he also taught 6,000 years followed by a 1,000-year millennial reign. And this is from his book Against Heresies. Thus then, the 600 years of Noah, in whose time the deluge, the flood, occurred because of the apostasy, do indicate that the number of the name of the man whom was consecrated the whole apostasy, 6,000 years in unrighteousness, in wickedness, in false prophecy, and deception. So he said, humans are going to have 6,000 years to do things the wrong way. Then afterwards, he says that when Jesus said, whoever has left lands or houses or parents or brethren or children because of me, he shall receive in this world 100-fold, and in that to come he will inherit eternal life. For what are the 100-fold rewards in this world? They are to take place in the times of the kingdom. That is the 7th day, which has been sanctified, in which God rested from all his works which he created, which is the true Sabbath of the righteous. So basically, Irenaeus was saying, there's 6,000 years for humans, and then there's going to be this righteous period of time for 1,000 years. Now this is in chapter 33 of his Against Heresies book. And then in chapter 34, he talks about what I read in Revelation 20. Blessed the Holy is he who has part of the first resurrection. Then he says, Isaiah 2 has declared the time when these events are going to occur. He says, and Lord, how long? He says, until the cities be waste without inhabitants, the houses be without men, and the earth left a desert. And going down to chapter 35 in his book, he said, this happens after the time of the Antichrist. The righteous are going to reign on the earth, waxing stronger by the side of the Lord. So he taught this. He also taught that after the time of Antichrist, the kingdom of God is going to be set up. Which the millennium is, but the Feast of Tabernacles helps picture. And there are other early leaders who taught this. But one thing that I found interesting in looking at church history is there's a Catholic saint and doctor of their church, a guy by the name of Jerome. And he ran across people who went to church on Saturday. They didn't eat unclean meats. They didn't believe in the Trinity. They used both the Old and New Testament for their doctrine. And they were called by him and some by Epiphanius, they were called Nazarenes or Judeo-Christians. And he wrote that they taught that the Feast of Tabernacles pictured the millennial reign of Jesus Christ. Now I realize this is not during the Ephesus era of the church, this is a little bit later, during the time of Smyrna Pergamus. But we see in early church history the idea that the Feast of Tabernacles pictures the millennium is not some invention of Herbert Armstrong. One reason I mention that is that some criticized the list of 18 truths and say that Herbert Armstrong basically made this stuff up and these things were not taught by early Christians. And that's simply not the case. The idea of a millennium was clearly taught by early Christians and others who professed Christ. And again, that the Feast of Tabernacles helps picture that. And in the Continuing Church of God, we keep the Feast of Tabernacles, and we know that it pictures the coming millennial reign of Jesus Christ on the earth. So anyway, that was the 9th truth. Now some of these won't take as long to go through. Now, the next thing Herbert Armstrong said in his sermon, the one he gave on the 17th of December, 83, where he's listing these truths, he said, now the truth regarding the Holy Spirit. He just said that, then he didn't talk about it any further. Okay? But also, in that sermon, he said that God is not a Trinity, and that's true. And he also, well, let's talk a little bit about something else that he wrote. Herbert Armstrong wrote about the Holy Spirit, The Mystery of the Ages, which is a book that he wrote. He says, no one can have the Holy Spirit, which alone can open the human mind to understanding the Word of God without complete repentance. There was a time when these two personages, that's the Father and the Son, coexisted. Nothing else did. No third person, no ghost. The Holy Spirit came from heaven. When it was seen, it was manifested. But this is in Acts chapter 2 he's talking about. And it says, Peter's quoting the prophet Joel, I'm going to pour out the Spirit. He says, that's the Holy Spirit, he says, and that's poured out. Can you pour out a person into another? He says, no. And he's saying that the Holy Spirit is not the third part of the Godhead. Now, when you look at early church writings, a story I want to mention. Someone came to my office about something else, and he happened to see a book in my bookcase. And he told his wife that, hey, I haven't seen that book since I took this class, graduate church history class at Fuller Theological Seminary. So I said to this man, oh, I took the same class, and that's where I got the book. And we were talking a little bit. Then the part that I found really astounding was, when I took that class, they wanted to teach you about the Trinity. And so the man said to me, what is your Christology? And what he meant by that is, how do I view the Godhead, etc. And I said to him, well, I believe what the early Christians taught. And this is funny, because this guy was a Protestant, I think. And he said, oh, so you don't believe in the Trinity? And I said, that's right. And if people look at early church history, they won't accept the Trinity. Now, I will tell you, the Fuller Theological Seminary does teach the Trinity. But one of the booklets or books that they have you get admits that there is a binitarian declaration of the Godhead in pretty much all of the Apostle Paul's writings. And they're like, yeah, Paul kind of said the Father and the Son were God, like all the time, but never about the Holy Spirit. So they find that a mystery. Well, the mystery is that they changed and decided that God was a Trinity when the Bible never taught that God was a Trinity. Now, if you go back to early church literature, you're going to find a couple of things. One is in the early second century, there's a guy by the name of Ignatius of Antioch. Now, in his writings, he referred to the Father as God. He referred to the Son, Jesus, as God. But he didn't refer to the Holy Spirit that way. So this is his letter to the Ephesians, chapter 9, verse 1. He said, using as rope the Holy Spirit. So he referred to the Holy Spirit as rope, not as a member of the Godhead. Furthermore, when you look at other writings, we find other people have a different view than mainstream Christianity, what passes for mainstream Christianity right now. For example, there's a person called Melito of Sardis. He was a Church of God leader. He kept Passover on the 14th. And I'm going to just read two brief things here. This is from his discourse, which was in the presence of Antonius Caesar. He said, Father and God of truth. So we see that he called the Father God. Now, this is something on the nature of Christ. It says, deity hidden in his flesh for being at once God, both God and man. So Melito said Jesus was God. He said the Father was God. Well, what did he say about the Holy Spirit? But before I say that, let me make a comment. While we in the Continuing Church of God consider that Melito was in the Church of God and a true saint, the Church of Rome and Eastern Orthodox, and most Protestant scholars would say that Melito was a saint. Okay, so one of their saints, if you will, who's actually one of ours, or God's saints, here's what he said about the Holy Spirit. He says, the tongue of the Lord, his Holy Spirit, in Psalm, my tongue is a pen. So we call the Holy Spirit the tongue of the Lord. So I have a tongue. It's not a third part of my personage. It's just part of me. It's not a separate person from me. I don't pray to my tongue. People don't pray to my tongue. You shouldn't pray to my tongue. or something along that, like, but people think they should pray the Holy Spirit, and it's a separate person. And here's something else that Melito wrote. And both of these are from the Oration on Our Lord's Passion, if you want to look this up. Also, by the way, at the cogwriter.com website, we have this article on the 18 truths. You can go there. The quotes are there. The references are there. So if you want to go and look up where I got these things, you can go to the original sources and verify that what I'm telling you is the case. Anyway, Melito said, "The finger of the Lord, the Holy Spirit, by whose operations the table of the law in Exodus are said to have been written." So anyway, Herbert Armstrong wanted to make clear that there were some misunderstandings in the Church of God, the Sardis portion of the Church of God, about the Holy Spirit. And as time has gone on, the remnant of the Sardis era seems to have more and more difficulty with what the Holy Spirit is. I actually talked to one of their former presidents on this particular subject several months, 8 or 9 months ago. I have to calculate precisely when it was. It was a while, it wasn't all that long ago. And he's indicating they're leaning more toward a Trinitarian view. They haven't officially taught it yet, but they certainly are losing more and more knowledge they had about the Holy Spirit. Now, getting back to Herbert Armstrong's list, in his sermon, the next thing he said, after he talked about the Holy Spirit, he said, this is number 11, "And the fact that we are begotten now, not you're not born yet, only begotten." Now, this may not sound as important in modern times as it was when Herbert Armstrong gave this sermon back in 1983. So, well, isn't that a modern time? Yes, it was, but there's a little bit of difference. Back in 1976, a Southern Baptist person by the name of Jimmy Carter became president of the United States, and he claimed to be born again. And I don't recall other presidents of the United States saying that they were born again. Maybe there were some, I don't know. But this idea about being born again in the flesh already was very popular in the 70s and in the early 80s. And so Herbert Armstrong brought this up. And he didn't really say much about the fact that you're begotten now in that sermon. But I'd like to read something that he wrote about, this idea about being begotten now, from a book that he wrote called The Mystery of the Ages once again. He says, "Now, as a physical male sperm finds its way to and unites with the nucleus of the ovum, so God's spirit enters and combines with the human spirit and mind. There is, as explained before, a spirit in man. This human spirit combined with the brain helps form the human mind. God's spirit unites with and witnesses with our spirit that we now are the children of God." And he says, Romans 8:16, "And God's Holy Spirit now combined with our human spirit and mind imparts to our mind power to comprehend spiritual knowledge." Then he cited 1 Corinthians 2, verse 11, "which the carnal mind cannot grasp. Now we have the presence of eternal life, God life, through God's spirit. In like manner, the human embryo was an actual human life as yet undeveloped. We are not yet immortal spirit beings, not yet born of God, just as human ovum was not yet born of its human parents, not yet inheritors and possessors, but physical heirs." And he cites Romans 8:17. "But if God's Holy Spirit dwells in us, God will, at the resurrection, quicken to immortality our physical bodies by his spirit that dwells in us." And then he cites Romans 8:11 and 1 Corinthians 15:49 to 53. Now, I'd like to read something the Apostle Peter wrote. This is in 1 Peter 1, starting verse 3. Peter wrote, "Blessed," this is 1 Peter 1, verse 3, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us," so Peter says we're begotten now, "again to living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time." This is consistent with what Herbert Armstrong wrote in The Mystery of the Ages about being begotten now. Now, is there any hint in the early church, any early church literature that people believed that they were begotten now. There is, but what I'm going to cite now is actually not from somebody who was actually in the Church of God. This is somebody who was in the Church of Rome. He's considered a saint by them. His name is Hippolytus. In the early 3rd century, he said, and this is from his Discourse on the Holy Theophany, chapters 9 and 10, "Come then, be begotten again, O man, into the adoption of God." So he talks about this idea. "For he who comes down in faith to this the layer of regeneration and renounces the devil and joins himself to Christ, who denies the enemy and makes confession that Christ is God, who puts off the bondage and puts on the adoption. He comes up from baptism, joined as his son, and becomes a joint heir with Christ." So he says we're begotten now. That was from Hippolytus. Also, in the 4th century, Athanasius, who the Protestants and Catholics consider a very great one, he said, "For God not only created them to be men, but to be called them to be sons, as having begotten them." For the term beget here is elsewhere expressive of how Jesus was begotten son. And he says, "I begot sons and I exalted them." So we see also from early church literature, the idea is there that people are begotten now by the Holy Spirit. Now, the 12th truth he said he restored was that we're born again at the resurrection. As I mentioned before, a lot of people claim that you're born again now. A lot of the Protestants do. So the sermon for the 12th item, Herbert Armstrong said, "You're not born yet, only begotten. That we will become born at the time of the second coming of Christ, when this mortal puts on immortality, when we won't be human any longer. We'll be divine. The knowledge that he is born of the flesh is flesh, and mortal is what we are. That's when you're born the spirit. You'll be spirit. Please, someone go and tell Jerry Falwell that, so he'll know he's not born again." Okay, is what he said in the sermon. And there are others. Probably one of the more famous people now who says, if you accept Jesus, you're born again, is Joel Osteen. I think he said that most at the ends of all of his telecasts. But the Bible, Herbert Armstrong said that you're born again after the resurrection. Well, what does the Bible say? Let's see what Jesus taught. Let's go to the book of John chapter 3. Nicodemus was confused when Jesus said you have to be born again. And Jesus said, starting verse 6, "Most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born of the water and spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. For that which is born of the flesh is flesh, that which is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I say you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but you can't tell where it comes from and where it goes. So is everyone who is born of the spirit." When we're begotten of God, you can see where we've gone. Okay, we're not like the wind. If we're born again, it says we're like the wind. But we're not born again now, we're begotten now. We're not like the wind. So Jesus was saying what happens once you're born again. Let's go to something the Apostle Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And I'm going to go to start in verse 50. Paul wrote, 1 Corinthians 15, verse 50. "Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed." So people who say that right now we've already been changed sufficiently, Paul's writing to Christians. He says, look, we're going to be changed. It's not like you're okay as you are. You're going to be changed. You're not born again yet. You're going to be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. So we know when it's going to happen. "For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed." And I read about that earlier in Revelation chapter 20. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So Paul is saying it right now, we are corruptible. And if you don't think you're corruptible, you don't believe what John said. John says if we say we have no sin, he's not in us. And even though we're not supposed to live in sin, we're just to strive to overcome sin, we still sin, we still make mistakes. We're still corruptible, and our flesh is going to die. And the Apostle Paul says that the mortal must put on immortality. Now, yes, I know he also wrote in 1 Thessalonians 4 that if we who are alive when Jesus comes, we'll be changed instantly, so our flesh won't go through the usual death process the way those people have had happen. But either way, we're going to be changed. In a moment, the twinkling eye, that's when we're born again. Now, does this exist in early church literature? Yes, it does. There's a man by the name of Theophilus of Antioch. He's considered in the so-called apostolic succession list of Antioch that the Eastern Orthodox Church uses. He's considered to be a saint by the Eastern Orthodox. He's considered to be a saint by the Roman Catholics. He's probably considered a saint by most Protestant theologians who believe in things like that. I say that because a lot of Protestant theologians don't really believe a whole lot of scripture. So, but anyway, getting back to Theophilus of Antioch, he appeared to be a Church of God leader. And he wrote, "But the moon wanes monthly." So you know the moon goes through its monthly cycle. He says, "When the moon wanes monthly, in a manner it dies." Now, we know the moon is not alive, it's not really dying, but he says, in a manner, it's kind of dead, because sometimes you have a full moon and it's really bright. Then you have a new moon, it's like it's not there, even though it is still there. And he says, it's kind of like dying. He says, this is being a type of man. How is the moon a type of man? Then it is born again and is crescent for a pattern of the future resurrection. So Theophilus of Antioch, who was a Church of God leader, says, future resurrection, you get born again. Because like the moon gets born again, that's what happens to us. So Herbert Armstrong's point that the early church believed in being born again at the resurrection, as I say, I just found this from Theophilus of Antioch. Now, I mentioned Athanasius in the previous truth. Athanasius also basically taught that we will be born again at the resurrection as well. Let me cut into something he said here. Jesus called the firstborn among many brethren because of the relationship of the flesh, the firstborn of the dead, because the resurrection of the dead is from him and after him. And he is the firstborn of many brethren and rose from the dead, the firstfruits of them that sleep. So, since it became him and all things to have preeminence. So he's saying that we get born again just like Jesus got born again, which is after the resurrection. Now the 13th truth that Herbert Armstrong claimed to restore comes next. From his sermon, he said, another thing that was restored to us is our own roots, our identity, who we are. Now he's saying this talking to Americans. He says, we are the tribe of Manasseh, of the lost 10 tribes of Israel, and no other church on earth knows it. The knowledge has been restored to this church, and God restored it to me 53 years ago. As I mentioned in the previous sermon on this, sometimes Herbert Armstrong was into hyperbole. When he said no other church on earth knows this, he meant no other Church of God, I think, at the time. There are some churches who believe that the United States is Manasseh. Now, you get any of this idea about the lost tribes from the Bible? Well, you get some idea about this. Now, after his resurrection, Jesus told the disciples in Matthew 28:19 to go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations. Now, I'd like to go to Galatians chapter 2. And I'm going to start reading verse 7. I'm actually going to read. Okay. It says, but on the contrary, when they saw the gospel of the uncircumcised had been committed to me, and the gospel of the circumcised was to Peter, For he who worked effectively in Peter the apostleship to the circumcised also worked effectively toward the Gentiles. Now, why did I read this scripture? Because Paul is saying, okay, for now God has kind of separated the leadership of the church in a certain way. I mostly am supposed to go toward the uncircumcised, even though Paul sometimes talked to the children of Israel. And Peter is mostly supposed to talk to the circumcised or the descendants of the children of Israel. Okay? Well, let's go to 1 Peter chapter 1. Is the starting verse 1. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the pilgrims of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father. Now the dispersion, or the diaspora, has been a term used by the Israelites who are not located in the area of Israel-Palestine. Okay, so Peter was writing to people who were spread in these other places, which would include people who were not necessarily the tribe of Judah. Now let's go to James 1 verse 1. As far as the identity of Israel, notice what James wrote, James 1 verse 1. James, a bondservant of God and the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad. So we see here from the Bible. From the Bible we see the disciples or the apostles knew that the tribes were scattered. They weren't all in one place. They weren't all just over there in the Jerusalem area. A lot of people do not seem to realize that. And Herbert Armstrong said this is one thing that he felt the Sardis era of the Church of God didn't fully grasp. Matter of fact, I should take this a step further. Herbert Armstrong actually wrote the head of that church at the time, who was A.N. Duggar, and he presented him a paper on the identity of Israel. And A.N. Duggar wrote him back and said, "You're surely right, but we won't teach it," which was discouraging Herbert Armstrong. Similarly, in my own, and it's one of the reasons why he left that particular church, which is the Church of God Seventh Day. In my own particular case, I understand what that was like. I was taught by the last church I was in that I was right about certain things that they had mistakes in and they were going to fix them, but then they decided never to fix them. So I can understand Herbert Armstrong is like, how can this be the true church or the faithful church if they say I'm right on something, but they won't teach it? And similarly, again, I felt, how can a church say they represent the Philadelphia portion of the Church of God and to knowingly teach error that they told me was an error, and they continued to do that? Well, anyway, getting back to the next truth, the 14th one, Herbert Armstrong immediately continued with our identity. And that opens all the doors. The understanding of prophecy has been opened to this church. This has been restored to the church. Now, this was a tougher one for me to find out from Scripture, the idea that knowing the identity of physical Israel would help understand prophecy. But you can find it in bits and pieces in the New Testament. For example, if you go to the book of Luke, the 21st chapter, I'm going to read something that Jesus taught. Now, most people don't seem to think of it in the context I'm going to go into, but bear with me on this. Jesus taught Luke 21, verse 24, "And they shall fall by the edge of the sword and be led away captive to all nations. And Jerusalem will be trampled by the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled." So there's something called the time of the Gentiles. Well, the time of the Gentiles comes after the final time of Israel. And you go through the Old Testament, especially the 48th and 49th chapter of the book of Genesis, you see promises that were made to the descendants of Israel, and blessings and promises which have been fulfilled in the 19th, 20th, and 21st centuries. That's going to come to an end because we're going to have the final time of the Gentiles that Jesus was talking about. Furthermore, I'd like to read something from the book of Colossians. Colossians chapter 3. A lot of people look over this because of misunderstandings of translations. as well as misunderstandings of history. So we're going to go to Colossians. Colossians chapter 3. And it'll start in verse 9. Do not lie to one another, since you have put off the old man with his deeds, and have put on the new man, who is renewed in knowledge according to the image of him who created him. Okay, fine. He's talking about, you know, we're supposed to act more like Jesus Christ. Put off the old man, the sinful nature, the carnal nature. Where there is neither Greek nor Jew. Okay, well, people know, okay, Greeks or Jews. Circumcised nor uncircumcised. Okay, people get this one. Barbarian, Scythian, slave nor free, but Christ is all and in all. Now, what people don't realize is, for example, in the New King James, it says there is no nor between slave or free. It was added because they felt that should be there. Well, it should be there just as much between barbarian and Scythian. The Scythians, some of them, were descendants of the children of Israel. And therefore, Paul knew this. And Paul assumed his audience knew this. Okay, why contrast barbarians and Scythians if people don't have an idea that the Scythians were descendants of the children of Israel? So this knowledge was known by the Ephesus era of the church. And as I said, I read that James said that this knowledge was to be spread abroad, that the 12 tribes were all over the place, and they knew this. Also in the first century, the Jewish historian Josephus noted, wherefore there are but two tribes in Asia and Europe subject to the Romans, while the 10 tribes are beyond the Euphrates till now, and are an immense multitude, not to be estimated by numbers. So Josephus recognized that there were 10 tribes that weren't part of Judea, and he wrote that they were part of or mixed with the Scythians, being the other side of the Euphrates. Now, some of those had migrated by the time he wrote that. Now, many of the Ephraimites and Reubenites were probably under Roman domination at this time, as well as some of the Manassites in the first century. But the fact is that the historian Josephus recognized also that all the tribes of Israel were not those people in Judea, and a lot of people do not realize that. I'm not going to go there, but in Revelation chapter 7, verses 4 through 8, we find that 12 of the 13 tribes of Israel are sealed. Dan is the one who's missing. And so we see that these are supposed to exist at the end times, and we see that their descendants still exist at the time the sixth seal is opened. You can read about that in Revelation 6, 12 through 17. And a lot of people do not realize this. They read the book of Revelation and say, yeah, okay, there's all these tribes listed at the end, so what? Well, there was a prophetic understanding of those. Some prophetic understanding that the first century church had, and that we in the 21st century in the continuing church of God have. Now I want to go to the next truth, the 15th one, according to Herbert Armstrong. In his sermon, he said, the second and third tithe, whether a church knows about that, that was restored by this church, that knowledge restored by this church. Though not mentioned further in that sermon, I will comment that second, third tithes are talked about in Deuteronomy 14, verses 22 through 29. And God specifically calls the third tithe, the holy tithe, in Deuteronomy 26, verse 13. Now Jesus said in Matthew 23, that tithing is still supposed to be done. Now, the children of Israel, by the way, did pay multiple tithes during the time of the apostles. I'm going to read something again from the historian, Jewish historian Josephus. He says, besides those two tithes, which I've already said to you I pay every year, one for the Levites and one for the festivals. So the one for the Levites is the one for doing the church, supporting the church, and the other for keeping the holy days. You are to bring every third year a third tithe to be distributed to those in want. So that's just from Josephus' writing, The Antiquities of the Jews, Book 4, Chapter 8, Paragraph 32. But even before the time of Jesus, there was a secular writer who wrote something called the Book of Tobit, who understood this as well. And one of the reasons I'm mentioning this by reading some of the Jewish sources is that there have been people who said that Herbert Armstrong made up this idea of second and third tithe, and none of the Jews believed in it. Well, Josephus said that he believed in it, he taught it. And from Tobit it says, taking the first fruits and the tithes of my produce and the first shearings, I would give these to the priests, the sons of Aaron, at the altar. Of all my produce, I would give a tenth to the sons of Levi who ministered at Jerusalem. So it's the same concept that Josephus was talking about. He said, a second tenth I would sell, and I would go and spend the proceeds each year at Jerusalem in order to keep the holy days. And a third tenth I would give those to whom it was my duty, those who were poor. After Jesus came in the second century, Jewish authorities in something called the Tosefta condemned the Judeo-Christians and their tithes, plural, indicating that the Christians who went to church on Saturday also were doing multiple tithes during the first and second century, during the Ephesus era of the church. And we also see some other records about that. And even the Church of Rome in the Catholic Encyclopedia claims the payment of tithes was adopted from the old law, and early writers speak of it as a divine ordinance and an obligation of conscience. And for those who want more information, we have an article about second and third tithe at the www.cogwriter.com website. And we also have an article on tithing in general at the same website. And again, this particular article on the 18 truths you can get at the cogwriter.com website. And it's got references and all that kind of stuff if you want to go further. All right, for the 16th, Herbert Armstrong immediately continued with in his sermon. Then the great deception, the counterfeit of Revelation 17:5, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth, her daughter churches and who they are. Those people in the Catholic churches and the Protestant churches have been deceived. So let's go to Revelation chapter 17. Where does Herbert Armstrong get this idea about Babylon and her offspring? Well, from the Bible. Verse 4. And a woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet, and adorned with gold and precious stones and pearls, having in her hand a golden cup full of abominations and the filthiness of her fornication. Verse 5. And on her forehead, a name thus written, Mystery Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and the abominations of the earth. Talking to one of my sons recently, and I was telling him that outside of a building in Rome is the St. John's Lateran Church. And outside of it, the Church of Rome has something in Latin that basically claims that the Church of Rome is the mother of all the world's churches. And if you can say it's the world's church because it's not the Church of God. And it somewhat ties in with this particular passage here. In verse 6 of Revelation 17, it says, And I saw the woman drunk with the blood of saints and the blood of the martyrs of Jesus, and I saw her and I marveled with amazement. Verse 7, But the angel said to me, Why do you marvel? I'll tell you the mystery of this woman and the beast that carries her, which has seven heads and seven horns. And you find out, if you go through it, that she sits on seven hills. Rome is known as the Church of Seven Hills. If you go down to verse 18, it says, And the woman whom you saw is that great city which rules over the kings of the earth. I mention that because some people have been confused about this, and this is a reference to Rome. Any Roman Catholics that are watching this, I want to make this clear. It's not Catholic bashing to say this is a reference to Rome, because you look through Church of Rome scholar writings, they said this is a reference for Rome. Now, there's an argument about the timing. Most Catholic writers will say, well, this is a reference to the Church of Rome during the time of Nero, or first, second century, or before Constantine, or whatever, but they will still admit it still comes from, or refers to, the Church of Rome. You don't have to go there, but I'm going to read Revelation 13, verse 18. It says, Here is wisdom. Let him who has understanding calculate the number of the beast, for it's the number of a man. His number is 666. It's been speculated that Polycarp, who was a disciple of the Apostle John, was the first Christian leader to come up with this. And Irenaeus, who claimed to meet Polycarp, came up with his own explanation of this as well. And he says, he talks about that then also led the Latinos has the number of 666. And it is a very probable solution that this being the name of the last kingdom of the foreseen by Daniel. For Latins, they who at present bear rule. I will not, however, make any boasts over this. So what Irenaeus was writing in the second century, and Irenaeus is considered a major saint by the Church of Rome, the Eastern Orthodox, and a lot of the Protestants, said, look, this is referring to the Romans who are overruling the Romans, but not necessarily the Romans who have us now, he said, but Romans in the future. Okay, so he knew this had to do with 666. And this is something, again, that the Church of God knew about this. Because, again, it looks like he got this from Polycarp. The Roman Catholic Bishop Hippolytus also basically tied this in with Rome. For example, he wrote, by the beast then, coming out of the earth, that would be from Revelation 13:1, it means the kingdom of Antichrist, the empire of Rome was established. He too will rule and govern. So we have another Catholic saint tying this in to Rome. Now, what about the idea of the Church of Rome and the Pope possibly being the Antichrist? Is this a new idea? Well, it was not an idea of the Ephesus era of the Church. Why do I say this? Because the Ephesus era of the Church ended in the second century, and there were no popes in the sense that we know them until the fourth century. There was a title, Pontifex Maximus, and that did exist then, and it's probable that the first and second century Christians thought it could apply there. But it was not until the fourth century that a bishop of Rome took the title Pontifex Maximus and became popes. They were just called bishops of Rome then. Now, the Catholic Cardinal Newman, back in the 19th century, is talking about the Pope being Antichrist. He said this sometimes is from the 4th and sometimes the 7th century when he was first announced. By whom? So the idea that the Pope was the Antichrist was announced starting in the 4th century. It was not until the 4th century that there was a Pope over the Church of Rome. And then he goes into later people. He says, you've got the Paulicians and the Albigenses who are calling the Pope the possible Antichrist. Well, some of the Albigenses, some of the Paulicians were in the Church of God. And you can read more about that in the booklet I mentioned before, The Continuing History of the Church of God. These people started to call the Pope as an Antichrist in the 4th century, because that's when the Pope took on the title. They associated with Rome. And again, if you go through church literature, you'll find that was known. Now, going back to the sermon, the 17th thing that Herbert Armstrong said he restored is as follows. And the fact that Satan the devil has deceived the whole world. Brethren, Satan is the one who is guilty. Those people in the Catholic Church and Protestant churches have been deceived. And I think they really believe. God just hasn't opened more truth to them. We don't sit in judgment of them. We're not judging them yet. We're going to do it, and when we judge them, all truth will be open, and God will take away the blindness from their eyes so they can understand if they're willing. Today, they couldn't understand even if they're willing. I don't think they're willing either, as far as that goes. That was Herbert Armstrong's opinion on that. As far as Satan goes, and being guilty, we can go to John 8, verse 44. Maybe one place we could look at. Jesus talking to the religious leaders of his day, the Pharisees. John 8, verse 44, he says, you're your father, the devil, and the desires your father you want to do. He's a murderer from the beginning and doesn't stand in the truth because there's no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own resources, for he's a liar and the father of it. Now, go to Revelation chapter 12. I'm going to read verse 9. And we're going to find something else about Satan. So the great dragon was cast out, that serpent of old, who is called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. So Satan deceives the whole world. He is guilty of deceiving the whole world. This is what the Bible says. And I alluded to Revelation 20, verses 1 through 3 before, but it says Satan is going to be taken away during the millennium. So, verse 3, so that he should deceive the nations no more, the 1,000 years were released, after these things would be released for a little while. Now, did early Christians like Polycarp of Smyrna know that Satan was behind sin? Well, yes, he did. Here's something that Polycarp wrote in his letter to the Philippians. Again, this is not the Bible. This is a second century writing from a Church of God leader. He says, "For whoever who does not confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is Antichrist, and whosoever does not confess the testimony of the stake is of the devil, and who perverts the oracles of the Lord to his own lust, and says there's neither resurrection nor judgment, he's the firstborn of Satan." I'm saying, if you won't believe these truths, Satan's behind this, and you're doing what Satan wants. So he knew that Satan was the guilty party as well. Now, the next truth that Herbert Armstrong had, the 18th one, and some of these truths, by the way, were not in the Tkach list. As a matter of fact, in 1986, in Worldwide News, Joseph Tkach put out a list of the 18 truths. But he didn't have truth 10 number, or 16, or 17, or 18. When we figured this out, he didn't have them in there, tried to figure out why, and for various reasons, but this particular one is one there's no way that the Tkach administration wanted to tell anybody about. We are to be separate. So here's what Herbert Armstrong said in that sermon. And how in Revelation 18:4 that God has called us out from among them to be separate. So we see that Herbert Armstrong says that we're supposed to be separate. And one of the things I've felt is set apart the Philadelphia portion of the Church of God from other portions of the Church of God was the fact that the Philadelphians believed these 18 truths, and Philadelphians did not want to be part of groups that didn't accept all the 18 truths. This is one of the reasons why when I left the Worldwide Church of God, I didn't go with a couple of groups, including the largest one, because they didn't accept all the 18 truths. And I felt if you're Philadelphia or a Christian, you're not supposed to be in a church that doesn't teach 18 truths. It's one of the reasons I didn't go there. And as far as being separate, well, the Bible talks about not being yoked together with unbelievers. So let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 6 from the Apostle Paul. Starting verse 14, Paul wrote, "Do not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers." Now, I'm going to make a comment here. In the continuing Church of God, I've told the ministry that you're not to baptize a non-believer with a believer. Okay? The only possible exception to that might have to do with a pregnancy issue, but as far as the Bible is concerned, this is not something people are supposed to do. We do not marry unconverted, unbaptized people with baptized people. You get no authority from this church to do that, and this is one of the reasons why. But Paul wasn't just talking about marriage here. He says, "For what fellowship has righteousness with lawlessness? What communion has light with darkness? And what accord has Christ with Belial?" This is one of the reasons why we in the continuing Church of God are not part of the ecumenical movement, and we will not be part of the ecumenical movement. Paul writes, "Or what part is a believer with an unbeliever? What agreement is the temple of God with idols? You're the temple of the living God, as God has said, I will dwell in them, and I will walk among them. I will be their God, they'll be my people." Verse 17, "Therefore, come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord." And one of the reasons that we're separate is the other churches don't really want us anyway, because they accepted a Trinity, which was not an original doctrine. So they consider us horrible or a cult or whatever name they call us. But the Bible says, Paul wrote, "And be separate, says the Lord. Do not touch what is unclean." We also avoid unclean meats. "And I will receive you. I'll be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty." Now, Herbert Armstrong mentioned Revelation 18. So we'll go to that scripture, starting in verse 1. "After these things, I saw another angel coming down from heaven, great authority." Cut down to verse 2. "Now a voice saying, Babylon the Great has fallen, become a dwelling place of demons. All the nations of the earth have drunk the wine of her wrath of her fornication. Verse 4, I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out from her, my people, lest you share in her sins and lest you receive her plagues. For her sins have reached heaven, and God's remembered her iniquities. Verse 8, her plagues are going to come on her in one day, death, mourning, and famine. She'll be utterly burned with fire, for strong is the Lord who judges her. We're not supposed to be part of the ecumenical movement to become part of end time Babylon. Now, interestingly, in the second century, Polycarp of Smyrna knew that the majority of people who claimed to be Christian were not Christian. He had run across people like Justin Martyr, who kept Sunday. He came across others who were heretics. He went to Rome, actually, and denounced the Bishop of Rome for keeping Passover on the wrong date. He denounced Valentinus, who's the first person who supposedly came up with the Trinity, according to some. And Valentinus is considered a heretic by the Church of Rome and the Protestants and the Catholics, and the Eastern Orthodox. He denounced Marcion, who didn't believe in keeping the Sabbath, and I think taught against the millennium. Polycarp went there to do that. So he knew there were a bunch of people who professed Christianity who weren't true Christians. And he wrote, and this again is from his letter to the Philippians, wherefore, forsaking the vanity of many and their false doctrines, let us return to the word which has been handed down to us from the beginning. So what Polycarp was writing is, look, don't do what the vast majority of people who profess Christ are doing. He says the majority. He says the vanity of many and their false doctrines. Return to the original word of God, the faith once for all delivered to the saints. That's what we're supposed to believe. We're supposed to leave these others. So the idea of being separate was again known in the early second century. Getting back to the sermon, Herbert Armstrong then continued with, well, brethren, all these things have been restored, and there's a mission of this church that's never applied, it's never been done by any other church. And the gospel of the kingdom has been restored and shall be preached in all the world for witness to all nations. So December 1983, he said, this gospel still needs to be preached in all the world, all nations. That was part of the mission of the Philadelphia church. If you go to the book of Revelation, why don't we go to Revelation 3 here. Starting in verse 7. It's the church of Philadelphia, right? These things... says, he who is holy, he who is true, he who has the key of David, he who opens, no one shuts and no one opens. I know your works. I set before you an open door. No one can shut it. For you have a little strength. You've kept my word and not denied my name. So we're supposed to be faithful to God's word and go through the open doors. Those open doors have to do with proclaiming the gospel. We have more information about that in our other literature. But he also warns, indeed, I'll make those who are the... this is Jesus speaking, by the way. Those of the synagogue of Satan who say they're Jews and are not, I will indeed make them come worship before your feet and know that I've loved you. Because you've kept my command to persevere. To keep God's command to persevere, to not change doctrine, to keep hold of the truths that restored to that era. I will keep you from the hour of trial that's going to come upon the whole world to test those who dwell on the earth. Those who keep those truths. I have long taught that basically, the Philadelphia portion of Church of God can be distinguished by a couple of things. One is the fact that it's going through the open doors to proclaim the good news of the kingdom of God. It also holds fast to those restored truths. And then you can read the rest of that. But that's something that's different about that. You know, now many in the Sardis portion of Church of God don't hold all the 18 truths. There's a bunch of other truths that they keep losing. And not all of the Laodicean churches of God hold to all the 18 truths, although some of them claim to do so. A lot of people compromise, they overlook aspects of integrity, and or they're really not truly committed to proclaiming the gospel, the kingdom of God, the world as a witness. And we have that these days. Now, what I want to do to summarize, beyond what I've just done, is just to read the entire list of 18 truths. And again, if you want more information on it, there's an article, the www.cogwriter.com website. So first, let me read this. This is from page 86 of our booklet, Continuing History of the Church of God. Herbert Armstrong wrote, "At least 18 basic essential truths have been restored to the true church," is what he wrote, and that was from the year 1933. Now, he wrote this in 1984, and in that particular booklet, he didn't list the 18 restored truths. He listed a few of them, but he didn't list them all in one place. The place to get them was from that sermon that I just read, parts of it, because that's where he listed the 18 truths. And I've talked to other Church of God leaders, such as the late evangelist DeBar Parthia, and nobody had any better place to look for the list than that particular place. But that list was Herbert W. Armstrong's list, not the Tkach list. It was from August of 1986. And part of the reason was, if you know much about what happened during the apostasy during the Tkach era, is they ended up becoming one of the world's churches. So it's one of the reasons why I'm pretty sure they didn't be separate as one of the restored truths. Because if they would have done that, people would have understood. Well, anyway, in that sermon, he lists the 18. So I'm going to list all 18 in order in case it wasn't clear during the sermon. Number one was the true gospel. And by that, he meant the gospel of the kingdom of God. People have a hard time in the Protestant churches and in the Church of Rome and Eastern Orthodox churches truly grasping the significance of the gospel of the kingdom of God. In the Sardis era, didn't fully grasp it. Herbert Armstrong felt that they didn't get it, and so something that he restored based on scripture, of course. Also, the purpose of God, that God's reproducing himself, three, God's plan for the holy days, and how the biblical holy days show God's plan of salvation. In the world, they've replaced many of the biblical holy days with pagan substitutes, and because of that, they don't understand God's plan of salvation. Number four, proper hierarchical church government. A lot of groups, since the breakup of the old worldwide Church of God and the apostasy and the breakup over there, do not accept hierarchical church governance. They don't believe that God has a structure and that certain offices are in a certain order, that kind of stuff. They don't accept that particular thing. They're more congregational or whatever. Again, as I mentioned in the previous part, hierarchical governance is scriptural, as well as was taught by the early Christians in the 2nd, 3rd, and 4th centuries and beyond. 5, who and what is God? 6, what and why is man? 7 was the spirit in man. And to remind people what that is, the spirit in man is why humans can think differently than animals can think. 8, the Christians are first fruits in this age. We're not the only ones that God is calling. God's going to call others. 9, I went over today, knowledge of what the millennium truly is, and, as Herbert Armstrong mentioned, that the Feast of Tabernacles helps picture the millennial reign of Jesus Christ on the earth. 10 was the truth about the Holy Spirit. 11 is that Christians are begotten now by that Spirit. And 12, but we will be born again at the resurrection. At the first resurrection, Christians will be born again. 13 is the identity of physical Israel, which is the reality that Israelites are not just people who call themselves Jews. There were other tribes, and that was known in New Testament times. 14, how the identity of Israel opens up understanding of biblical prophecy. As I mentioned before, you see in Revelation the listing of 12 of the tribes, more than just Judah. 15, second and third tithes. The second tithe helps finance things such as the Feast of Tabernacles. The third tithe also helps help the poor. 16, the identity of Babylon and her daughters. And in this age, as we see more and more going on in the ecumenical movement, I think that's more and more important to realize what's happening there. 17, that Satan has deceived the world. It's not that those in the Greco-Roman Protestant churches are always intentionally doing bad things. They've been deceived. They don't tend to believe Church of God doctrine. They claim to believe what this book says, when it really comes down to it, sadly, that they don't, and that's because Satan has put up a variety of deceptions that many have fallen for. And last is that we need to be separate. And during this time where we see ecumenical movements going on, you may find out that those of us who don't want to be part of this are to be called extremists, and we're not cooperative. But we are supposed to be separate. So I hope going through this two-part sermon, I've given you a better grasp of what those 18 truths were, as well as the fact that you can find information about them in the first, second, third, fourth, or whatever centuries. So those who claim that Herbert Armstrong made all this stuff up and nobody in early times believed all of these things was simply not the case, because that can be documented. And we do document that in the article I mentioned, as well as a lot of doctrines are also documented in our free booklet, Continuing History of the Church of God. This is Dr. Bob Thiel for the Continuing Church of God.